The name Savage featured a great deal. "Is he all right?" asked Shunter. "I expected to get my head bitten off."
"Well, I shouldn't really say, but..."
"Ah, yes, I'm outside the circle of trust."
"Look, you know the score," said Jane quietly. "We've been struggling to get anywhere with this case, and this is the first concrete lead we've had. Any suspect is going to give Blunt a hard-on."
"There's a mental image I could have done without, but... Look, can you do me a favour? I only said that it looked like Savage. The photo is very blurry, and he has a generic kind of face. There isn't much distinctive about him, so please bear that in mind, and don't go in all guns blazing when you catch up with him."
"Duly noted. Your best bet now is to stay well away from here. Get out while the going's good."
"I don't need telling twice," said Shunter. "Just go easy on Savage. He's probably not the man you're after. I can't really call the guy a friend, and he's very difficult to get on with, but I've never known him to be violent, and I really can't see him murdering anyone."
"I'll do what I can," said Jane.
At the Empire Hotel, Miss Clark returned the phone to the receptionist.
"Well, he was very rude," she said.
"He didn't take you seriously?" asked Mr. Jacox.
"Not at all. Perhaps I forgot to tell them something pertinent."
"I think it's more that D.I. Blunt is a complete arse," said Mr. Horningtop.
"Tell me again why you think Miss Greeley is being held captive," said Mr. Jacox.
Mr. Horningtop tapped his smartphone.
"It says here on this website that in My Brother's Keeper there is a character called Honoria Gilderdale who discovers that she has a long-lost older brother whose reappearance threatens her inheritance. So she invites him to her house, drugs him, and then locks him away in an attic room for years, denying to all and sundry that he even exists.